progress, and that that part is vast. But that the material progress has been immeasurably vaster, I think you will concede. Now, I have been looking over a list of inventors, the creators of this amazing material development, and I find that they were not college-bred men. Of course, there are exceptions, like Professor Henry of Princeton, the inventor of Mr. Morse's system of telegraphy, but these exceptions are few. It is not overstatement to say that the imagination-stunning material development of this century, the only century worth living in since time itself was invented, is the creation of men not college-bred. We think we see what these inventors have done. No, we see only the visible vast frontage of their work. Behind it is their far vaster work, and it is invisible to the careless glance. They have reconstructed this nation, made it over, that is, and metaphorically speaking, have multiplied its numbers almost beyond the power of figures to express. I will explain what I mean. What constitutes the population of a land? Merely the numberable packages of meat and bones in it, called by courtesy men and women? Shall 1,000,000 ounces of brass and 1,000,000 ounces of gold be held to be of the same value? Take a truer standard, the measure of a man's contributing capacity to his time and his people, the work he can do, and then number the population of this country today as multiplied by what a man can now do more than his grandfather could do. By this standard of measurement, this nation, 2 or 3 generations ago, consisted of mere cripples, paralytics, dead men, as compared with the men of today. In 1840, our population was 17,000,000. By the way of rude but striking illustration, let us consider, for argument's sake, that 4 of these millions consisted of aged people, little children, and other incapables, and that the remaining 13,000,000 were divided and employed as follows: 2,000,000 as ginners of cotton,